it's awkward that you're sitting like this right next to me, because I guess you can see the cues too, which I don't really want, because what if they send in, like, pervy weird cues? That does happen sometimes. Okay.
So what happens if we have to ask the questions that have come in on the feed?
Yes, yeah, but also people sent in questions in advance. And we are live, but I'm just going to give people, like, one more minute to get situated and make sure that they're here.
They can
with
get
us.
On and see now?
Yes. Okay. It's available. Okay, it's 1:30. Fantastic. Hello, everyone. My name is Sarah Grant for Poker News. I'm joined by Eric Danis of the GPI and, of course, the man of the hour, Mr. Sam Trickett, who we have been catching up with twice a week, in fact, every week since the World Series of Poker started, because you guys can share 10% of Sam on everspoker.com. All of his winnings for the series this summer, you have the opportunity to win 10% of those. Hold on everspoker.com. Okay, so we're having a Google Hangout. We've got a bunch of questions already here for Sam, and we also have you guys available to just throw in your questions right now. Try to keep it PG-13. Sam's really trying to keep a straight game lately, right?
Yeah.
He'll keep it PG-13 on there. He's not a party boy anymore. This is serious summer of Sam, so he can win you guys some money. Let's go out to our first question from Anthony. Who is your favorite player in the World Cup, and besides England, who will win that?
Ronaldo is my favorite player.
Like Ronaldo, the guy who comes to the EPTs?
No, the other one.
The attractive one.
Right,
Cristiano Ronaldo.
Yes.
Cristiano Ronaldo, yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, I just think he's a complete athlete, and he's just the most effective player in the world. And he was obviously at Man United and won the league single-handedly on his own, so I'm a little bit biased. But, yeah, Ronaldo and...
Oh, wait, that is a different question, so let me just throw that in really quick while we're here. Why did United suck this year? From Rich. Ooh, oh, see, I don't know anything about football,
they did suck.
They did suck.
I've got to put my hands up. They did suck.
And you have a football background, yes.
Yeah, I played
so
a lot of football.
You should have some ideas.
Well, the manager, we got a new manager. We had a new manager, and he wasn't very good, and he wasn't really... he wasn't good enough, simple. As simple as that, basically, and got his tactics all wrong in the big games. And yeah, and he bought some bad players, too. He bought Fellaini for a lot of money, and he didn't improve our squad at all, so...
I always say blame the managers, whatever the situation you're in.
I mean, he's sat now, we've got a new manager, and I'm sure we'll have a better season. Even if he doesn't buy any players, I'm sure he'd do better than they didn't waste it.
Was it impossible to replace, to be the next guy after Mr.
Yeah, Thomas? I mean, Alex Ferguson's the best manager ever lived. It's always going to be difficult to follow him anyway. But so he had a lot of pressure on his shoulders, and I'm sure that didn't help, and he just seemed to bottle it, I think. Yeah. I mean, he seems like a nice guy, but... You know, when he started managing Man United, he had like normal hair, like just dark hair, and by he finished, he had grey hair, and he aged like 10 years.
That's what happens to
in 8 months.
That's right.
Yeah, so I felt a bit sorry for him, really, but you know, it's a big job, and hope Van Gaal as well from now on.
Next, okay, so then besides England, since apparently they suck, who will ship? Oh wait, no, United sucks. England doesn't suck. Who else will ship the World Cup?
Well, I think. Obviously, Brazil are the favourites, but they weren't too impressed with them in the first game. But I feel like an outside tip or a good value bet, if you like. I've gone for Germany. You know, I tipped it in the magazine before today. It's not because they won 4-0 today. But I did tip them, yeah, because they're just a good football inside, and these Germans, even in poker, they just seem to excel, don't they? Yeah, they're machines, so I like the way they play, and you know, I can see them having a good World Cup.
I hope that everyone can hear us. Let us know if you guys can't hear us, because I can barely hear Sam, and I'm sitting right next to him. I want to just
I'll try and speak up.
Okay, now, from... This is returning to the poker world. First off, apparently you're living in a house, as do a lot of the big players, with your mates. Who are you living with?
Chris Sly. He's a PLO cash game player. He's the most annoying housemate by a mile. he'll play Chinese poker like till like 3 or 4 a.m., and he's playing like... Small games, $10 a point, and he'll just scream the house down if you know, makes a bigger hand and I'm trying to sleep. And I just drives me mental being woke up when I'm trying to sleep. Especially if I'm like playing today, I'll have to be awake to come see you guys.
Yeah.
Like, I wanted to get some extra sleep, but he woke me up, so I was up for like 2 hours in the middle of the night arguing. But other than that, the guys are good to live with. Little brother, say Romanello.
Yeah, I love Roberto.
Yeah, he's from the old Italian background, so he cooks us some healthy meals. And Jared Solomon. You know, he's a good friend of mine in Hollins, Virginia. So we got a good team back there. We're doing awful. Not one of us have cashed a tournament. So
it's
the
early.
House is doing really poorly, but I'm sure we'll come good by the end of the series.
Well, I think then you basically answered. The question was, who do you live with and who's the cook in your house? I'm guessing someone knew the answer to that question before they put it in.
Yeah.
That did come from someone named Roberto, that's
probably yeah, Roberto is an excellent cook. He's always pasta, though, that's the thing. He's so slow, you fill up every day.
Yeah.
So it's not, I mean, I'm sure I'm going to put on a load of weight because I haven't gone home, but whatever, it's nice to eat nice food.
So it's healthy, but a dangerous healthy.
Yeah, it's just pastas and carbs every day, and you stuff yourself, and it makes you feel bloated.
I love it.
But no, it's good. I appreciate the meals.
So then, though, when your lady comes, does the dynamic sort of in the house shift? It's like, okay, now it's time for you guys to put your underwear in the drawer, and, like, Mama's going to be cooking from now on.
Nah, not at all. She's getting a hotel room with the Aria. She's no way she'd stay with us. Yeah. So I'm going to go join her at the Aria when she gets here.
And that'll probably be the best week of sleep of the whole
Yeah, I'll sleep series. Well, and I'll do normal things like go to shows and stuff like that and going to dinner every night with her, so... kind of looking forward to it. Obviously, we're a bunch of slobs.
A little respite yeah. from the bachelor
and, like,
lifestyle.
Some nights people are going out, and nights out, and they're coming in at like 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning, banging the doors. It's just, it's a bit of a,
like
a bit
same
of a
used to do, right?
Yeah, like me last year. So they're getting some payback on me.
It's hard. It's definitely like living with people changes your relationship for sure. Everybody just has horrible like idiosyncrasies that make you crazy eventually. Speaking though of your lady, someone asked, where did you meet your fiancé, and do you like her being into poker?
Question, I like that question. I met her when I was like 15 at a school disco. She went to a different school, but I just went to the disco randomly one night. And,
the disco?
The school disco, yeah.
Oh,
and so cute.
I like kissed her there, and then 3 years later down the line, I started dating her or whatever, and then kind of went from there. I've been with her since. I mean, we broke up for 6 months when I moved to Cape Town.
You tried that single life and you didn't like it.
Yeah, we stayed in touch too, and so the whole way through. But yeah, so I've been with her ever since, really. And I don't really want her to be involved in poker now, just because I mean, I talk so much poker with my friends. A lot of my friends know poker, and I talk poker with them. And almost when I'm away from, you know, poker playing, I just don't really want to talk any poker. Talk enough of it. It's my life, basically. I live poker, so last thing I need is to wanting to do an interview, for example, for sites and stuff. But
it's a conversation outside.
I like that she understands, though. I like when she comes to watch me on the final table and she knows what's going on. She knows, you know, I mean, she can understand what cards she needs to come for me to win and stuff. Like when my mum came to Bartouche, she had no idea what a diamond club or a spade was, you know what I mean? So when she was all in, she just didn't have no idea what was going on, and I would prefer her to have known more so she could actually cheer. But, so, I mean, it's the right balance, but I hope she doesn't get too involved.
Has your mom figured it out since then?
Put
in the hours so she knows what's going on?
I doubt she's put in the hours, but she's getting there, yeah. She knows the rules now, so maybe if I make a big final light in the future, she'll understand what's going on.
Like this summer?
Yeah. Right.
We can meet her and do a little, like, hanging out on the rail with this is Trickett.
Yeah, that'd be amazing.
Yeah, I like it.
She's lucky. She's only been to one final and I won, so.
Cartouche. Yeah. This is a big one. Okay, here we go. This is a weird one, and it's only a three-word answer, and I'm not sure. Sometimes I can't tell if these are, like, inside joke questions or they're really realistic questions, so I just go with it. Describe Andrew Feldman in 3 words.
Got to be careful here. I don't think I'm allowed to say the words that first came into my mind. No, I'd go dishonest, cheat. And disrespectful.
Okay, obviously,
yeah,
I don't know the story.
I mean, I thought about it. I mean,
you don't know the story.
I tried.
Yeah, what is the story?
He just...
This is about the cheating thing in France.
Yeah, I just let him close to me. I didn't want him to be close to me, but I was convinced to let him close to me. Looked after him, helped him out in a lot of situations, borrowed him money left, right, and center. He borrowed me some. One day I borrowed him some money. He decided to get out of poker and just decided he didn't want to pay me back and give me no reason whatsoever. Actually wrote to me and said, I think you're one of the nicest guys I've ever met. Well, sorry, I'm not paying you back. And literally no excuse. And then he would like send me smiley tongue faces, like winding me up.
Oh, nice.
Gave me the needle as well by some little kid. And he was just irritating more than any guy I've ever known in my life. And yeah, so I don't like that guy. I like him. I get on with everyone. Like, I've got very few enemies, you know, if any, outside of Feldman. And it's just so irritating to have be owned by just a little kid like that. And then I see him doing all this charity work, like giving to, on the TV in England, he's like giving to charities.
Giving like, your money to
crying on TV, like. And I mean, I probably shouldn't say this, he's probably going to try and sue me. But the truth is, I'm going to court in a minute anyway. I'm in a court case, I'm trying to get my money back. You know, I don't really see how I can lose. So I just can't wait for that to be over, just to feel like I...
Redemption.
Yeah, exactly.
Justice.
Yeah, it's just disgusting. It winds me up every day, you've got me steaming again now. I'm just going to go play. You interviewed me today, I talked about Andrew Feldman. Every time I interview, she talks about Andrew Feldman. And I just go steam off. I think it's your right, I'm not getting no cash.
I think it's interesting though, because I was just having a conversation with my fiance this morning. He was lending money to a friend, and I think outside of the poker world, in my opinion, I would argue that it's usually not a great idea to lend money to people just in general. However, in poker, it's almost inevitable that you will have these dynamics of shifting money between players and, you know, taking percentages and stuff. So it's kind of, I think, hard in this industry to avoid that. And then with the friendships and relationships that you have also, to not ever let the money thing become a part of it. Does that ever happen in, like, are there lots of other dramas that seem to evolve just because, like, the friendships are always involving business and money too?
Yeah, I mean, like, I've borrowed guys money that are close to me a few times, up to the same amount of money as what I lent Andrew. But, like, you know, just a few hundred pounds for bills and stuff like that, and it's just so awkward for me to ask for that back.
Right.
When I know they're struggling as well, like, I haven't really got a valid reason to ask for it back.
Right.
In my eyes, like, I just say, can I have my money back? But I just can't bring myself to say it, so the truth is
So it's almost like a gift every time, like, can I borrow money? Okay, fine.
You didn't give guys money, and, you know, I mean, the good guys obviously will mention it, say, oh, I need to pay you back.
Right.
The truth is, you're the back of the list all the time, and it's, like, it's a little annoying, but whatever, like, I know them guys would do it for me, so... that's how I look at it. If she was on the other foot, they would do it for me. So, you know, I'm happy to help these people, but yeah, effectively, you're just giving money away. and it's not a great spot, because the best case scenario is you get your money back.
Like, yeah, deal.
And, if you don't lend it, like, he'll probably think, he's got loads of money, why is he going to borrow me? Yeah, so it's not a great spot, but whatever. It's, I suppose I'm lucky to be in that situation.
Outside of poker? Sorry, but outside of poker, do you find that people in your real life also, after, like, you know, you take second in the one drop or something, that people emerge from the, like, your second cousin from
right.
your mom's uncle all of a sudden is like, oh, I'm in a jam, Sam.
You have no idea. You have no idea of the investment opportunities I've been given to.
Yeah, of course.
These bad investments of, yeah. like, and I feel pressured, and I've got involved in a few just to try and help them out. But, yeah, obviously, the situations like that come up a lot, and I've had some really bad ones of guys I don't know who are telling me that their family's, you know, terminally ill, and it's just like, what do they do? Like, and it's like, it's just difficult to say no to people that pour their heart out to you and stuff and are desperate. But, I mean...
Blame it on your wife. That's what my fiance does. He's like, my wife says no more. I can't lend any more money. And I'm like, that's easy. Like, you can't piss off your wife, right?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, whatever. I mean, I've come up with a few excuses here and there, and I try and work out if it's genuine or not, but it's just some guy sat in his bedroom trying to get money out of me. It's like, so it's difficult, but whatever. I hope to think I've made some good decisions in the past and help people out and got some satisfaction from that at least.
Yeah, of course. Yeah. I didn't mean to cut you off.
No, here. It's great. Talking about the positive side of UK poker.
Yeah. I just come on here moaning. Yeah, I just found a way to moan about every answer.
We do have Max Silver, who's running very deep today.
Okay.
It's been a slow start for the UK pros. You ready to party or to rail fellow countrymen?
Yeah, I would love to see. I mean, John Cabat won a bracelet. Nice
right,
to see.
Yeah.
I like him. He's a good guy. And did Barney final the other day, right?
He did, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I've got some results, but the truth is, it's just not that many English players here this year. Like, a lot of them just love the football, and that's what, you know, a lot of them have gone to Brazil or they're watching it in England with all the friends, and that's what they enjoy. So a lot of them have chosen to just, you know, to sit this one out and maybe come back later in the series for the main event and whatever. So, maybe towards the end of the World Series, you're going to see a lot more English players doing well.
So we're not going to expect a crazy rail today if Mr. Silver goes
like, it's really weird. Like, the whole trip I've been here, I've not been up to scrap. I've not been 100% like, fit condition. Like, got this problem. I thought it was acid reflux, but I'm just like, producing a lot of gas. And it's like, but it's been all day. And when I eat food, it's making me feel horrible and stuffy. So, like, almost when I bust the toilet, I'm just going home and being on the sofa and not doing much. I've got some more tests this week that I've got to go for. So. It's a little bit concerning, to be honest. At first, I thought it was acid reflux, it's not going. They gave me some tablets, it's not going. So I'm just kind of thinking, when's this going to go? So I'm going for all these tests now. And hopefully, when I'm feeling 100% I'll get some more results.
Sure.
We missed you guys. I think, was it last year where it was just, like, written all day, every day at the final tables? Maybe the year before?
Yeah,
it was, like, one of my, I think my second year, maybe third year in poker, and I was just like, oh, I can't wait to get on the rail. It's going to be so fun. And then this year, it's been kind of smooth.
Yeah, I was all doing the shoe bombs, suddenly going mental. They took railing to a whole new level, didn't they? It was like football matches almost.
Yeah. We've had some great winners, but not a lot of great rails. So just get it together, guys. We want to see you guys here. And besides you, obviously, who do you think will win the one drop?
Oh. Easy question.
In my opinion, like, from I've only just started playing the tournaments again, and obviously I played a lot of high rolls and I got a lot of experience against end players, so my opinion on those guys is a little bit more accurate. But I think that, like, Philip Grissom for me is the toughest player I've played against. He's obviously got great results, but he plays well against me, and I always think he's up there with one of the favourites for most tournaments he enters.
And he just got here a couple of days ago.
Did he? Oh, right. Yeah. Okay, yeah. So he's fresh and ready. So maybe him. I'll talk a single-handedly one player.
I think this is a really interesting one, and you may or may not actually know or remember this. What is the biggest pot you've ever seen go down in a Macau cash game, and what happened? I know it's tough.
I'll tell you the biggest pot I know about. I didn't see it happen, but it's a way more interesting story.
I like it. Let's go with it.
So I'm going to get the details a little bit wrong, and obviously I wasn't there. So,
This is a gossip show. Let's go.
I'm like 90% it happened, basically. So, but I'm not going to say who the players are. But, blinds was 100,000, 200,000 Hong Kong. It's pretty big.
What is that in USD?
It's like 16,000 pounds. So,
wow.
It's
that's
like
12, a lot.
24 maybe or something. Maybe I'm a little bit off. You get the idea.
Yeah.
They're playing like 4 or 500, and they the recreational player limps in. A Chinese pro, young pro, raises to like a million or whatever. Aggressive player, pro, re-raises to like 4 million Hong Kong. The guy who limps in calls, pro calls. Turn, the flop comes, ace 5-3 with two spades. C-bet of 7.5 million. Call by 7.5 million from the limper. Overcalled by the pro. So pot's getting big, obviously.
Huge.
I might get the sizing a little wrong, the pot a little wrong, but you get the idea.
Yeah.
The turn is a deuce. So the fours are straight, which the deuce of spades, and so now I'll flush it. Goes bet, 12 million. Call 12 million. Fold. But like a little think and a fold, right? The pro thinks a little bit and folds. The river comes, there's the board, so it's a three. So there's like ace 5-3, deuce 3, and it's a flush there.
Yeah.
And guy jams all in for 65 million into a pot of similar amount. I mean, I think it was bigger. It was like 1.5 times the pot. It's like 60, 70 million, which is like a huge bet. Like, you can do the exchange and work out what it is in the US, but it's it's around the $22, $23 million pot. And the recreational player literally takes 30 seconds, looks his cards, and he says, "You can't have anything." And just calls him with top pair, ace king. And and have you know, the pro was bluffing. And the sickest bluff I've ever heard of. And the pro just whips over like 10-8 suited.
He was like, "I'm just triple barreling so hard every
just
time."
Random bluff. And he just took off and just doubled like 1.5 times pot of the river for like, he'd been playing 45 hours too, and he was winning. And then he was tired. At one stage, he was literally falling asleep at the table. And then, he wakes up and runs this bluff. He's like, he's a sicko. So I was like really impressed with the bluff. I was like, he's got like, the biggest balls ever. So, fair play to him. Like,
40? Did you just say 45 hours?
Yeah, he was playing 45 hours, then he ran that bluff. So I just think he's a
is
sicko.
Is that even
I love
possible
it,
without drugs?
Yeah, they don't do drugs.
45 hours?
Yeah, I mean, I play 40 hours with no drugs. Some guys pros take Adderall.
Yes, that's what I'm referencing, obviously.
This guy doesn't take, I'm not sure what he's doing.
He's just living on that magic poker adrenaline.
His stakes are so high. Like, you just get your adrenaline going every pot. Like, obviously, we're smashing into the Red Bulls and the coffees and stuff. And every time you win a big pot, it gives you like another life of energy. But yeah, it was just funny, to call there with top pair, the guy had the king of spades, and he was just like, he's not even a pro, and he analysed it so well. He was like, "You haven't got king flush, you can't have three aces, I have an ace." And he said, "The guy that thought for a while. He probably folded an ace, so you can't have anything. It's only aces, basically. He just called. I was like, obviously a really impressive bluff and a really impressive...
Yeah, even more impressive.
I mean, I don't like the bluff. I'm not going to say it's impressive by any means, actually. I think it's a really terrible bluff. Because he's just repping everything on every street. I can't believe he had the balls to do it, so I've got to respect him for that. So, yeah,
is this
it's a cool hand.
Like four or five handed, is that kind of standard for the Macanese cash games?
Yeah, it's all different. They change all the time. I haven't been to Macau for 6 months, so I don't really know what's going on at the minute.
But it's still profitable to play a game like that, even when.
They're just so sick out there that, like, you could go there and you could take, you know, 20, 30 million to the game, and then they'll. Sit there and you'll play, and then they'll be like, yeah, we're kicking it up because one guy got stuck. So now they want to increase the blinds, and now all of a sudden you're sat with like the biggest amount of money ever on a table ever. What, you're playing 20 big blind poker or something. So it's obviously, it's a sick game,
totally
but it's addictive. You know what I mean? It's like, I love getting involved in that game. It's just so exciting.
Poker player. Spoken like a true poker player. Right. Well, do you have any more questions, Eric, before we wrap this bad boy out?
One question quickly.
Let's do it.
It's going back to the one drop. Your favorite memory from that great moment, I assume a great moment, even though it was a second place finish, it was still a pretty cool amount of money and a pretty big event.
Yeah, obviously when I made the quad threes against the not flush with Tony, that was like probably single-handedly the luckiest situation I've ever been in my life.
You'll take it.
Well, poker-wise anyway. So I was like, that's what you dream of on the final table, and I've been on the wrong end of a few of them in some big pots in Macau, and I got myself down a little bit. I was thinking, when's my time going to come? And I remember when the river came, I was like, please. Finally, it's here now. You know, I really thought I was going to win. I thought once that happened, I was going to win. But Tony played well, and he ran well. So it was just never going to win. It was just his time to win. So no regrets. Played okay, and yeah, that was a single-handed my favorite Pokemon.
Unless you're a baby, you've got lots of time.
Yeah, it's true.
You've got lots of time to make more. Well, you guys don't forget to check out everestpoker.com where you can share 10% of Sam. Also, we didn't get into some of your questions, but don't worry. I interview Sam twice a week every week. So I'll get these questions today, and you can find them on pokernews.com. I will even shout out to you. So be sure to check that out. Share 10% of Sam this summer on everestpoker.com. This is Eric. I'm Sarah. This is, of course, the man of the hour, Mr. Sam Trickett. Thank you guys so much for watching.